Amen, amen. Good morning, church.
Good morning.
Oh, yes. People are actually not the decaf crowd. This is amazing. Thank you so much. Hey, my name's Glenn. What a joy it is for me to be able to preach God's word today. I'm so glad to be here. Really glad to be with you. So, hey, a quick health update. If you didn't know, back in January, I was diagnosed with lymphoma. And I have great news to report. I had a PET scan a couple Mondays ago that came back clean and clear. Yeah. So thank you, thank you, thank you for praying. Jesus is healing me.
Amen.
And I still have some more chemo treatments to go before I'm out of the woods, per se. But y'all have taken such good care of me and my family. Thank you for the cards, the gifts, lots of food, as you can see by just looking at me. We just feel so loved and taken care of and covered in prayer and grace from God through this church. And so many of you have played small but very significant. I think that you may think it's small, but it's such a significant role in my family's life in this season. So thank you so much. Hey, last week was Easter. And so I have a public service announcement. Jesus is still alive. Amen? He's still alive. Some of us, right now, judging by the look of your face, I don't know if you believe it, but Jesus is actually still alive. And so we celebrate that. I just want to say, what happened last week is the present reality that we live in. When we say Jesus is alive, people getting baptized, coming to faith in him, that's not reserved for one special Sunday. That is the everyday, every week life of a Christian church, is to see people come to faith in Jesus, because he's still seeking and saving the lost. He's still redeeming lives. He's still bringing about his kingdom, and we love to participate in that. That's why we planted this church. So, hey, if you want to meet me in John chapter 7, we are in the middle of a sermon series that's exploring the eyewitness account from the Gospel of John of the life and ministry of Jesus. John writes in the 20th chapter, 31st verse of the book of John in your Bible, as to why he wrote the book. And it was so that we might believe that Jesus is the Christ, the Son of God, and that by believing in him, we may have life in his name. That's the reason John was written. That's the aim that we take every time we open up the book of John and we explore whatever chapter we're in, is that we would believe that much more that Jesus is the Christ. He's worthy of our faith, and that by believing in him, we would have life in his name. By way of introduction, can we talk about some controversies this morning? Does that sound like a fun thing to do in church on a Sunday morning? Let's talk about some controversies. So controversy, if you didn't know, is defined as a discussion with two opposing points of view. Now, in our culture, in our present day, I don't really know that discussion typically is a part of controversy. Usually it's just two opposing views entrenched with no discussion. Controversy is not new to us, right? You say anything that's an opinion, boom, controversy. If you give your perspective on something, boom, it's controversial. I want to just share a couple of really simple, non-threatening controversies. You know, Chick-fil-A versus Raising Cane's. That's a controversy. BK's got a strong opinion. I don't even know what it is. Hopefully it's Cane's. But Backstreet Boys or NSYNC. To the kids in the room, you have no idea who that is, but we have strong opinions, believe it or not, about that. On our staff team, everyone except for me thinks that it is GIF. I think it's JIF. Lex just said you're wrong. Maybe I am, maybe I'm not. Is it classic Disney animated, or is it all the Pixar since Toy Story came out? I mean, come on, those are controversies. Now, let me just make it a little bit more significant. Okay, make your hair stand a little bit. Let me just say some phrases. Gun control. How about capital punishment? Social justice. Equal rights. A host of other topics. Controversy. What I want to propose this morning, though, is that the greatest controversy ever is found in a person, and it's Jesus. Jesus is the great controversy of human history. Every single man, woman, and child has to come to a place with Jesus. Everyone has to come to a personal conviction about who Jesus is or who he is not. It's inescapable. He does not leave us in the Christian scriptures to be in a middle ground with him. He is either Lord of all, Savior, Redeemer, alone the way of salvation, or he is nothing that he says he is, a lunatic, and completely and totally a liar. We will either choose one or the other, and that will be the dividing line of history. And in our chapter this morning, in our text, we're going to see what I think are some of the most polarizing moments in the ministry of Jesus. John chapter 7 is no joke, a frenzy of drama and controversy surrounding who Jesus is. And fair warning, as we explore this chapter together, there's going to be an ultimatum that the Word of God puts in front of us. We bow the knee to Jesus as Lord, we receive his grace in our lives, or we reject him, and in doing so, we call him a liar. That's what's at stake. I've titled this sermon, Receiving Jesus When the World Rejects Him. Receiving Jesus When the World Rejects Him. What's going to happen is Jesus in this chapter is going to go to great lengths, to show us and plead with us that he is actually God. And then he's going to describe some of the response of true believers who don't reject him, but instead choose to follow him. Let me set the scene. And friends, there's so much happening in this chapter. It's 52 verses. We don't have a chance to go through every single verse. But let me set the scene. There's so much. So they're at a feast called Feast of Booths. It's also called the Festival of Tabernacles. You might have that titled in your Bible. What this is one of three Jewish holiday tradition celebrations that would happen annually. And what the people would do is they'd come together and they would recall their deliverance from slavery, the Israelites, in Egypt, and how God provided for them for 40 years in the wilderness, in the desert, before they made it to the promised land of Canaan. Families would gather together with leaves and branches and any, you know, tool that they could acquire, and they would actually build booths, like little shelters, little tents, if you will, on top of their houses or out in front of their houses, and they would live and occupy that as a family for 7 days to remember God's great deliverance from Egypt. I want you to know that, in particular, the Feast of Booths would draw everyone, every Jewish man and his family, every Jewish guy over 20 and his family had to be there. And it was a joy-filled, by far the most celebratory of the feasts that happened through the years. And everyone was there. Everybody showed up. It was the talk of the city of Judea. And so in this particular chapter, as I'm reading through it with its setting and its dialogue and its character and its intrigue, it kept reminding me of like a mystery dinner where there's all these different characters and all this different dialogue, and it's a lavish party, and there is murder in the air. See, you may not know this, but John chapter 7, even though it's only the 7th of 20 chapters in the Gospel of John, we're turning a corner here. The rest of John chapter 7 is the last 6 months of Jesus' life. We're already on a speeding train toward his crucifixion, and there's already a target on Jesus' head. The people who don't want him to have the influence that he has and don't want him to have the following that he has. I want to do something kind of at the outset to just give you a picture of what's happening in this chapter. We're going to do a flyover, and I'm going to show you the different reactions just in John chapter 7 to who Jesus is and what he says. So, for instance, let's start in verse 1. The Jews, the religious leaders of the false Judaic religion at the time, who did not want Jesus to be who he said he was, were seeking to kill him. That's verse 1 right out of the gate, an opinion and an attitude toward Jesus. Verse 5, his own brothers, his blood brothers, are seeking, didn't believe him, didn't trust in him, didn't think that he was God. Verse 7, the world hates him. Verse 12, oh, he's a good man. Verse 12, he's leading people astray. Verse 20, he's demon-possessed. Verse 26, he may actually be the Christ. Verse 30, The Jews are seeking to arrest him. Verse 31, many believed in him. Verse 40, he really is the prophet. Verse 41, he is the Christ. Verse 44, let's arrest him. You don't have to convince me, and I hope I don't have to convince you that Jesus is controversial. Amen? Everybody has a thought pertaining to him, but why? Why? Why is everyone discussing him, everyone looking for him? Why is he on everyone's mind? Why the great controversy? Well, we know that Jesus, up until this point, has been spending time in Galilee. He's been doing miraculous healings and signs and wonders. He's been casting out demons, but here's the catch. Jesus is never really the suspect of controversy because of what he does. It's because of what Jesus Christ says. It's always Jesus teaching. It's always the words that come forth from his mouth. It's always the controversy surrounding his words. Jesus, from the beginning of his ministry, has been calling people into repentance. He's been calling them to turn away from their life of sin, wherein they're the God, and they determine what's good and evil and what's right and wrong, and to turn toward God, to obey him, to surrender and worship him as God instead. Jesus has been calling out people's sin. In chapter 7, verse 7, he literally tells his brothers, the world, they don't hate you, but they hate me because I testify that their own works are evil. That's what gets Jesus in trouble. From the beginning of his life, he was making exclusive claims that no one was making. Church, let me just tell you what Jesus claims. And I want you to come face to face with what Jesus claims about himself. I just want to kind of summarize some of the bold things that he says. Jesus claimed to have the right to be honored and worshipped on an equal basis with the eternal God. This is a man who is indistinguishable from any other Jewish person that they knew. Just a regular, looked like a guy, like a man. And he's saying, I have the right to be honored and worshipped as the eternal God. Jesus said that he came down from heaven. Jesus said that he eternally existed, never had a beginning. He said he was sent into the world by the Father. He claimed to be the only Savior of the world. He claimed to be the determiner of everyone's eternal destiny. He claimed to be the only source of everlasting life. The only way to God. He claimed to be one with the Father. He claimed to have the power to give life, and he claimed to have the power to raise the dead. He claimed to be able to raise himself from the dead. He claimed to be the supreme judge of all men who would one day judge them all at the return, at his return in glory. He claimed to be without sin and to have the power and the authority to forgive sin. He claimed to have the right to answer prayer. He claimed to be greater than the Jewish temple, greater than the great King Solomon, greater than Jacob, greater than Father Abraham. He claimed to be the only source of soul sustenance, the true bread of life that could feed the soul. This is what makes Jesus the great controversy. This is ultimately what moves people away from him. You see, the theme of John chapter 7, unfortunately, is one of rejection. It's one of hate. It's one of animosity toward Jesus. An assassination plot is already underway. A target is already on Jesus from the false leaders and priests of Judaism. And I just don't want us to miss this, church. Jesus, throughout the gospel, is marked time and time again with a plea to come, invitation after invitation, an extended hand after an extended hand. A longing, a giving, a pleading, for people to come to him. Over and over and over again, Jesus was always offering himself to everyone, always inviting people to place their faith in him, always giving grace. I want us to just put ourselves in that for a moment. Isn't that us? Like, when you think about your testimony, if you're a believer, the times that it took for God to make an appeal to you over and over and over and over again. And what we see in our text is that people turn away from him for every discernible, illegitimate reason. And that's my story. It seems like it takes us forever to finally see who Jesus is, forever to finally respond to him in faith. And if we can't see the heart and the character of God right here in our text, just even in this chapter, Jesus is going to give plea and plea and plea. He just continues to pursue us, does he not? He continues to offer himself to us while we sin against him. He continues to say, it's okay, I'm going to try again. It's okay, I'm going to show you again. It's okay, I'm going to reveal myself again. It's okay, I'm going to demonstrate something anew, again, afresh to you. Will you come to me? That's the heart of our God. That's the love and the grace and the mercy that he continues to give to sinful people. I think in this chapter, the sinful condition of our human heart, our natural inclination to reject God, our natural inclination from birth to not want him, to ignore him, is shown. Jesus is there in the flesh, in their midst, and people are choosing over and over again to reject him. But he keeps pursuing. And what's going to happen is we're going to pick up in verse 14 of the text. And Jesus is going to kind of divide the line between two groups of people. One are the people who finally see and understand him for who he really is. They kind of see through his appeals. They see through his reasoning. And they choose him. And he's going to shut out the people who don't. He's going to tell the people who don't, you're blind. He's going to say, I'm only with you for a short period of time, and then I'm gone, and you will not be able to find me. And so I want us to pick it up in verse 14, John chapter 7. About the middle of this Feast of Booths, Jesus went up into the temple, and he began teaching. The Jews, John calls those people who are the false religious teachers, the Pharisees, the chief priests, the Jews, therefore marveled, saying, how is it that this man has learning when he's never studied? And so Jesus answered them, my teaching is not mine, but his who sent me. Reason number one that Jesus gives to believe in him, my teaching is divine. I don't have a teacher. No one teaches me. There is not a rabbi that I go to. There is not a book that I quote. There is not a rabbi that I quote. There is no degree that I need. I speak the very heart and the very mind of God. I need no teacher. And if you will see and listen and understand this teaching, you will see that it is not coming from a man. It's coming from heaven. My teaching is not mine. Jesus makes this appeal a lot in the Gospel of John. And here he is once again saying, you marvel at my teaching. I mean, even later in this chapter, there are soldiers, officers that are sent to arrest Jesus. Listen to this. They come back to the chief priests who sent them, and the chief priests say, where is he? Why didn't you attain him? And their answer for not arresting Jesus wasn't that he got away from us or slipped into the crowd. It was, no one teaches like this man. No one says the words that this man says. Jesus' words of power were enough to make the knees buckle of these officers who were sent to arrest him. Nobody's going to thwart God's plan and his purposes. Throughout chapter 7, in fact, you see Jesus say, my time hasn't come, over and over again. Jesus isn't going to get arrested by somebody. This is God's sovereign hand on the Son of God so he can carry out his mission to the cross. I digress. We continue in verse 17. Verse 17, if anyone's will is to do God's will, he will know whether the teaching is from God or whether I'm speaking on my own authority. This is where Jesus begins to sift the true disciples. He looks at these people and he says, you're going to understand that this teaching is from God if your will is to do God's will. See, I think oftentimes we think that a disciple of Jesus is someone who comes to Jesus and first and foremost says, Jesus, what can you do for me? Jesus is saying that a true disciple of his is someone who comes before God and says, God, what can I do for you? How can I serve you? You are the maker of all things. You are my master. How can my life line up with your will and your wants and your desires? Simply because you are God and I am not. Jesus is saying, look, listen to my words. Look at my works. I am in this for the will of the Father. I'm not in this for my own selfish gain. In fact, he's going to continue in verse 18. The one who speaks on his own authority seeks his own glory, but the one who seeks the glory of him who sent him is true, and in him there is no falsehood. I wonder if you can understand the portrait Jesus is painting here of himself. He's saying, listen, preachers that go around and talk and speak and have a huge following that are in it for themselves are not to be trusted, not to be believed. And here Jesus is, this amazing orator. Crowds are coming to listen to him. And he's saying, I'm not in this for my own selfish ambition. I'm not in this for my own vain glory. I am in this to do the will of the Father who sent me. Do you know what that would look like for Jesus? Can we just pause for a moment? That looks like he prayed in John chapter 17. He said, Father, restore to me the glory that I once had before I came on this mission. Jesus gave up his throne and his glory in heaven to come to earth to become a defenseless child in a manger, to grow up and live a life that you and I experience, to be tried by every temptation, and to be sinless. And Jesus, he gave up everything divine to come and be a human just like us on this earth. And Philippians 2 says that he took the form of a servant. And he didn't die for righteous church people. He died for sinners. He died for people at their worst. John the Baptist, if you remember in the earlier chapters, declared him the Lamb of God who came to take away the sin of the world. Jesus would come to the point of death on a cross like a lamb before its shearers was silent. He went to the cross. He proclaimed in the Gospel of Mark, he said, I did not come as God to be served, but to serve and to give my life as a ransom for many. How is it that you can look at me and my teaching and what I'm doing and think that I'm in this for me? The Father will get the glory, and that glory will be shown in the salvation of people who are undeserving. That is the appeal that Jesus is making. He continues in verse 21. After Jesus answered them, I'm just going to read it. I did one work and you all marvel at it. Moses gave you circumcision, not that it's from Moses, but from the fathers, and you circumcise a man on the Sabbath. If on the Sabbath a man receives circumcision so that the law of Moses may not be broken, are you angry with me because on the Sabbath I made a man's whole body well? What Jesus is saying is you have a tradition of circumcising the Jewish people on the Sabbath, which is supposed to be the day of rest that you religiously keep and you don't do any work, you will circumcise people. I healed a sick man to display the goodness and the grace of God, and because I broke a rule, you think I should be tried for that. He's saying, I came before you and put the glory of God on display and miraculously, physically healed a man, and you hate it. So the appeal that Jesus is making here is that he's performed miracles in front of them, and they're trying to find something wrong with it. Yet another sense of rejection from people, another one in a long line of people hating Jesus and turning from him. So what Jesus does in summary is he appeals to the source of his teaching, he appeals to the selflessness of his mission, he appeals to the motivation of his work, he appeals to his display of God's goodness and grace through healing. He is giving all these clear reasons as to why he should be believed. And starting in verse 25, it seems like some people might actually start to be convinced. Verse 25. Some of the people of Jerusalem therefore said, is not this the man whom they seek to kill? And here he is speaking openly, and they say nothing to him. Can it be that the authorities really know that this is the Christ? Then you get to verse 27. And right as it seems a seed of faith is being planted, right as it seems that doubt is fading away, right as it seems that people might be believing, verse 27, but we know where this man comes from. And when the Christ appears, no one will know where he comes from. Just like that, doubt creeps back in. Just like that, a rejection, a reason to not believe. Let me just tell you, this is a weird and unfounded notion that the people had, that Jesus would have some sort of supernatural appearance where he would just poof out of nowhere and show up. When all of the Old Testament scriptures speak of a child born. Speak of someone coming from the line of David. Speak of a real person growing up. And these people had this notion that Jesus was going to appear out of nowhere, and they're looking at him and saying, we know this guy's dad, Joseph, the carpenter. We know his mom, Mary. He's from Nazareth. So forget every miraculous work. Forget every testimony of healing. Forget the fleeing demons that he's casting out. Forget all of these appeals. Forget the teaching that's otherworldly and powerful and clear that comes from a man who's not learned at all. This can't be him. It's not him. It's got to be someone else. Can't you see our hearts reflected in that? Well, I want to have faith, but. And the list goes on and on and on. If you're not yet a Christian here this morning, I want to make an appeal to you. We are coming up on some verses here that are going to resound in your ears and hopefully strike your soul in a way that changes you. I wonder if you're listening to the words that Jesus is about to say right here before our eyes, Jesus Christ. He has a few things to say to people who continue to have doubt and continue to stave off his invitations for too long. And under the authority of God's word, God has something to speak to those who've rejected him. As Jesus in the flesh is standing and looking at the most learned and educated people when it comes to God, right? The chief priests, the Pharisees, those who have the very oracles of God, the Jewish scriptures, Jesus looks at them, and he says this in verse 28. So Jesus proclaimed, "You know me and you know where I come from, but I have not come of my own accord. He who sent me is true, and him you do not know. I know him, for I come from him, and he sent me." You don't know God. If you did, you would receive me. You want to talk about controversy? That's the most controversial thing that Jesus could say. Friends, let there be no controversy in our lives pertaining to Jesus. He makes plain in the scriptures that if you reject him, then you don't know God. You can't honor God. You can't love God. You can't have God as your father. And no matter your religion or belief system or self-described relationship with God, no matter how good of a person or benevolent a person or kind of a person or servant hearted of a person you think you are, if you don't know Jesus, you don't have life. If you don't know Jesus, you don't know God, because Jesus claims over and over again to be equal with God, and the only way to be equal with God is to be God himself. I want to just show you his words and let scripture speak for itself. John 5, sandwiching chapter 7. John 5, 42 through 43. "I know that you do not have the love of God within you. I have come in my Father's name and you do not receive me." And from John 8:19, "You know neither me nor my Father. If you knew me, you would know my Father also." Jesus Christ is the one true God. There is no other. I was not born a Christian. None of us were. And I grew up in church. My dad was actually a pastor. And believe me, I never thought I'd be a pastor. It's a whole other story. But growing up, I did not ever examine the claims of Jesus. I didn't ever just open up the Bible and think, what are the words that Jesus is saying? What's the appeal and the claims that Jesus is making? I never made it about Jesus. I made it about church. I made it about relative do-goodedness. I just thought that's what it is to be a Christian. You go to a church and you try to be a good person. Can anyone relate to that? Like, that's our notion. That's where everyone just drifts to instantly, is that's what it is to be a Christian. It's not that you are dead and you've been made alive. It's that, you know, you're kind of a bad person. You need to be a little bit better of a person. And to be honest, most of my life, I would say that my notion was just to kind of build a God like you would build a bear. You just kind of pick the things that you want to be true about God and his commands and the things that he says and his nature and his character, and you just kind of ignore the things that you don't like. And so what I would do is I would just pick some Bible verses in certain seasons that would be, you know, kind of food for my soul, and would just kind of ignore the whole counsel of God. And that was just kind of how I lived my life. It was just kind of a coasting through. But along the road, I had to face Jesus. When I was in college, I had to come to terms with Jesus. See, at some point, you can no longer speculate or imagine a version of God that suits you, but you really do have to face this ultimatum of the Christian scriptures where Jesus is revealing everything to you, so you don't have to speculate anymore, and he's saying, you either believe in me as God or you don't. And I had to come to a place where, okay, I'm either going to bow my knee to Jesus as Lord of my life, or Jesus Christ in all of the scriptures and the billions of people that place their faith in him are fools, liars, lunatics, most to be pitied. There's a dividing line because I think the evidence is overwhelming and demands a verdict. And for me, it made it very helpful that I examined the resurrection of Jesus, what we celebrated last week. Jesus having new life, Jesus raising himself from the dead was the turning point for me. And so if you're not yet a Christian, I want to ask you to examine Jesus. And I want to ask you not to ignore the appeal that he's making to you. If you're not yet a Christian, would you turn to Jesus today and would you recognize him as God? I want you to understand that Jesus is not just making an appeal for you to know him as God logically. He's offering you really, really good news. The good news of the gospel is that God has done for us what we could never do for ourselves. The good news of the gospel is that God comes for us in our sin when the wrath of a holy God is due to us. And Jesus came and he bore our sin for us. He died on a cross in our place, a sinner's death that was meant for us. And then he rose victoriously from the grave to conquer Satan and sin and death itself. And the good news of the gospel is not just that we are freed from the penalty of our sin, but also that we can be free from its power. It's that we can actually have a new life, that we can be born again by the Spirit of God, and that we can walk in a freedom that we've never experienced before. So this plea for you from Jesus to come and to know him as God is not just like, either know me as God or don't. It's like, if you know me as God, everything changes. And it's all for the better. And you can be reconciled to the one who made you. And there is no other way. There's no other name by which men can be saved. It's only through Jesus. It's so hard to read through this chapter and see time and time again the red letters. And Jesus saying, come, 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 come. And the people just find reason after reason, illegitimate, to not believe in him. So I would just plead with you, if you're not a believer today, would you see Jesus as God? Would you bow the knee to him in repentance and in faith? And would you let him completely change your life? I want to talk to my born again friends in the room. Those of you who are Christians, can I build your faith a little bit this morning? Listen, this chapter in John, your faith in Jesus is so legitimate. It's so right, and it's so good. It's fitting. The evidence is overwhelming in favor of Jesus being God. You should have faith in Jesus, and the fact that you do is amazing. Rejoice today. Take heart today. Be encouraged today. Be entrenched that much more today that Jesus is your Savior. He's your redeemer. He's your friend. You've chosen rightly. If we go back to the text, verse 31, the crowd asks an amazing question, and it reflects how we ought to respond to Jesus. Many of the people believed in him. They said, when the Christ appears, will he do more signs than this man has done? Pastor David Guzik comments on this saying, it is fair to ask, has anyone done more than Jesus? If Jesus is not the Messiah, if he's not the Savior, if he's not God, then when Messiah comes, will he do more miracles than Jesus? Will he love more remarkably than Jesus? Will he suffer with more courage than Jesus? Atone for more sinners than Jesus? Raise from the dead with more triumph than Jesus? Ascend to heaven in greater glory than Jesus? Will he present a greater gospel than Jesus? Will he change more lives than Jesus? Free more addictions than Jesus? Comfort more grief-stricken hearts than Jesus, renew more minds than Jesus, restore more marriages than Jesus, triumph over more tyrants than Jesus, gain more followers than Jesus, raise from the dead like Jesus. None of this is possible. No one can do more than Jesus did, and he deserves all our confidence, life, and faith as the Messiah. Amen? Oh, man. And we're not done. I got more good news. Listen, one last appeal from Jesus in our text. Arguably the most essential. If you're a believer and you've believed in Jesus with logic, you've examined his claims, you've found him to be convincingly God, but maybe this morning you feel far from him. You feel distant from him. I've got a word for you. Jesus has a word for you. I wonder if right now in your life you would say you're unfamiliar with the comfort of his love. You're unfamiliar with the nearness of his presence, the closeness of his fellowship in your everyday life. May I remind you, Christian, of the good news of God the Spirit. God the Spirit, the third person of our triune God. Don't quench him. Don't neglect him. Don't ignore him. There's really good news for you. Don't we want to walk with a God who isn't out there, up there, doing his thing while we're down here doing our thing, but one who is an ever-present help in time of need? One who is as close to us as the very breath in our lungs. One who is a comforter. One who is a guide to us. Do we not want one who makes a clear and present difference in our everyday moments of life? Is that the kind of God that we long for? Yes or no? That's the Spirit of God. Jesus made a promise when he ascended into heaven after he rose again. He said, I'm going to leave and it's going to be for your benefit because I'm going to send a helper. I'm going to send someone to be with you. I want you to look right here. Verse 37. On the last day of the feast, the great day, the climactic moment. Literally, just let me give you context real quick. The people are literally pouring water. They're doing a water libation ceremony to celebrate God's provision of water and rain in the desert for those 40 years. And Jesus, he stood up and he cried out. He only does this four times in the original language. Cried out. If anyone thirsts, let him come unto me and drink. If anyone thirsts, does anybody thirst here this morning? Does your soul have longing? Is there more that you want? If anyone thirsts, let him come unto me. Whoever believes in me, as the scripture has said, out of his heart will flow rivers of living water. Now this he said about the Spirit, whom those who believed in him were to receive. For as yet the Spirit had not been given because Jesus was not yet glorified. We live on the other side of the cross and the resurrection. And the Spirit of God has been given to people who believe in Jesus. Practically speaking, that means you are never alone. Some of y'all have come in here this week, and your week has been filled with what I would just call dry places. Dry moments. Spiritually, emotionally, mentally dry. My week this week sucked. Just going to be honest. Chemo treatment doesn't feel good on your body. I have been told that I'm cancer-free, but I'm still putting toxic chemicals in my body that have long-lasting potential side effects. I'm in a dry place. My daughter, almost three, is potty training. She didn't want to poop for 4 days. I literally am on the bathroom floor, typed half of this sermon on my phone, coaching her. She finally did, praise the Lord. That's the biggest thing that y'all celebrate. So my wife and I, we have a seven-month-old. She's been croupy and coffee all week, so we're surviving. We're not thriving, right? I'm antisocial this week. The weather was garbage all week. Didn't help me at all. I'm homebound, you know. It's just like, this is life in a broken world. We live in a fallen world. We have limitations where we get exhausted, amen? We also have weak and feeble minds often and hearts that will not receive the grace of God in moments when we need it most sometimes. You may be in a dry place. I want you to know that we have a spiritual enemy, the devil, Satan, and he loves to occupy dry places. And here is Jesus Christ saying, are you in a dry place? Do you thirst? Come unto me. Drink of my grace. Streams of living water will flow from your innermost being. The Spirit of the living God can indwell you. Do you know what that means, church? That means no more dry places. That means dry moments in our life are a thing of the past. That means there is not a moment, there is not a situation, there is not a crisis, there is no trial, there is nothing in our lives where God is not present and near and speaking and moving and working. Even if we don't see it, even if we lack the faith to believe it, the Spirit of God is there. There are no more dry places. I love that I can live a life that is naturally supernatural. That there is not a thought that can go through my mind that I can't take captive and surrender to Jesus and let him speak to it. That's how personal and near God is through his Spirit. And lastly, streams of living water will flow through you. We're not a bucket. We're not merely a reservoir that receives God's grace, that receives the good news of the gospel, that receives the presence and the power of the Holy Spirit, and then that's where it ends. We planted this church because we believe we live in what we call a beautiful desert. Nice homes, picture-perfect families, spiritually, a lot of dry places. Streams of living water means that God has invited us into his mission with him. Some of y'all, myself included, you're kind of like a stagnant, gross, nasty pond right now. And you need some spiritual Drano so that the water can flow through you and not just to you. Can I get an amen?
Amen?
This is the idea to be on mission with God. He is bringing wholeness, restoration, healing to people. Would we be streams of living water that don't just receive his Spirit and rejoice in his Spirit, but as we're blessed, we would become a blessing to other people and they would see Christ through us. That's what it is to be a light in the city. That's our namesake. Let's pray. God, I want to ask right now that anyone who does not have faith in you, Jesus, would see your appeals this morning, would choose to love you, and would not feel like they're inconveniencing anyone here to talk and speak of it and to be public with their faith. And God, I also want to ask, Spirit of God, that you would fill us afresh today, that we would believe the cry of Jesus. If anyone thirsts, let him come unto me. Whoever believes in me, streams of living water will flow from within his or her heart. God, help us to believe that today. Help us to know that we can have a daily conscious awareness of you. God, I'm mindful right now that thirst is the lack of something. We are empty, incomplete, discontent, and dissatisfied apart from you. Satisfy our thirst today as we worship you, Jesus. In your name we pray. Amen.
Amen.